following the Soviet Union and early Russia non-military tech history, you can think there were only bootlegs or copies of the Western technologies in our country. Lada 2101 car? Fiat 124. Electronica MK85 Calc? Casio FX700P. Dendy? Nintendo Famicom. I chose only three not to take a lot of your time. Soviet appliances and devices have lots of cloned ones. If you dig a little deeper, you can even think that Soviet Union was somewhat like modern China, a country where you could get any tech quite similar to the original, but much cheaper. Not in such quantities, of course, and quite hard to purchase in the 20th century if you were just an ordinary Soviet citizen. It's a long story, but in brief, there were shops in the Soviet Union not every citizen could attend, even if he had money. But interesting thing, despite all of that, Soviet scientists made discoveries too. And Soviet Union also produced quality gear. It's a shame not a lot of people know about it. High-tech devices for the time. Sometimes original and sometimes modified from aboard technologies. But unfortunately, mostly times this not only never spreaded anywhere outside Soviet Union, but didn't even become popular here in our country. And today I decided to correct this injustice and start an additional series on Russian Video Game Comrade channel. Hello YouTube, your Russian Video Game Comrade Victor is here, and you're watching Soviet Tech Tales. In today's episode I want to talk about compact discs. Everybody knows that CD is a digital optical storage media that was co-developed by Philips and Sony to store and play digital audio recordings. It was introduced in 1982 and quite fast took over the world with almost no competitors. But what if I tell you there could be at least one, and it was developed in Soviet Union 3 years earlier, in 1979. Yes, maybe development of a digital audio format started in the USSR a bit later than in Japan. But around 1975, Soviet government assigned a group of scientists and engineers to this project. It wasn't a trivial goal, and people today even doubt it was a desire to make a new format just for consumers of music. The most possible option was that government wanted to somehow use this technology for military needs, as almost all innovations in Soviet Union were forced to fulfill military objectives. All the civil techs could be easily copied from Western products, but not military ones. Anyway, researchers had to find a way to transform analog sound to binary code and store it on an optical media, standardize the process and also write technical documentation so factories could start mass production of both the new media and players for it. As there was no CD standard yet, the most challenging part was to find chemical composition that could change its physical properties under the influence of a laser. Soviet scientists solved the problem and invented an optical digital plate that worked very close to Sony's and Philips CD invented 3 years later. It was also a 120mm in diameter plate, but a little thicker than original CD, and early information states that it was made not from polycarbonate plastic, but from glass. I'm not sure is it right, but I found that interesting, so I decided to tell you this assumption. In 1983, in Soviet magazine Radio, there was an article about the second version of the Soviet CD player. And it was said there that discs for it were made from polyvinyl chloride. But the very first ones could be different, as it was a prototype. The format was not 16, but 11-bit PCM encoding, but also at a 44.1 kHz sampling rate per channel. In 1978, the first working player prototype Ray 001 was assembled. It was divided in two parts. Upper one contained optics, mechanics and controls, and the lower part was entirely a digital decoder. The main problems of this player were out of focus, out of tracking and engine control. And all of them were caused by the laser used in this player. It was a helium neon laser LG75, a huge and heavy thing, 20 cm, almost 8 inches, in diameter. If you ever wondered how a CD player works, you may know that in ordinary CD player, disc whirls on its axis and motionless in the plane, and the laser head moves reading it. As the laser here was too big, Soviet engineers had to make spindle with a CD move towards the laser. I'm illustrating this now with an interesting thing. Several years later, Sony made some CD players using the same technology. It was named fixed pickup. Ray 001 was made in a single copy and was used in a lab for research and development of the laser sound recording technology. And in 1981, Soviet Radiotechnics Research Institute that made Ray 001 started assembling an experimental batch of consumer's version Ray 002. It was very similar to the first one, but a little modified and contained only discrete elements made in Soviet Union. Units from this batch were sent to different exhibitions, and one of them was even shown to public in 1982 in Moscow. People had a huge interest in it, but unfortunately, Soviet Radiotechnics Institute couldn't provide mass production of this. After all, they weren't a manufacturer, they were a research institute. And rumor has it that they didn't even make 100 units of Ray 002. And as for CDs, it was even more complicated. Researchers had a clean room to make CDs, but it also wasn't meant to be used for mass production. They say that there was only one test CD with a song from 1978 Soviet movie A Hunting Accident that was bundled with CD players for the test. And it was it. I couldn't find the TV ad for Ray 002 from the presentation, but I have a scan of a Soviet magazine Radio from 1983. In quite a big article, they say that this is a new thing in audio techniques. And someday, every Soviet citizen will use this as their main music player. And yes, technically in 10 to 15 years they did, but not this one. After the presentation, lots of Soviet manufacturers contacted Research Institute in struggle to get technical specifications and start producing new revolutionary durable records with a great sound quality. Even the biggest Soviet manufacturer of vinyl records wanted to produce CDs, and at first it seemed that Ray players would become huge in no time. But as soon as everyone realized all the complications of production, they backed off. No one in Soviet Russia had such technologies themselves, and the only way to make CD players alive was collaboration and joint work. And if it was a government, military project, it could be achievable. Factories had to set up production of microchips needed for the players, optical and mechanical parts no one made for the time in Soviet Union, and the most important, manufacturers had to set up a mass production of a semiconductor lasers. Long story short, all of this together was impossible in the USSR at that time. At least not for some music stuff. But head of every manufacturing company wanted to make such a player, as it could promise a huge profit, and wanted to make it alone, not to share this profit with anyone. And the precious time was lost. By the end of 1983, it became clear that Sony's and Philips CD got worldwide recognition, and trying to compete with them was just useless. So, all the work made by brilliant minds of Soviet researchers and engineers was lost and forgotten. Some of them left Soviet Radiotechnics Research Institute and got work in the Marine Physics Instrument Lab in Leningrad. After the introduction of compact disc format, they got technical documentation with standard descriptions and hardware samples quite quick, and having a background with their Ray project, they designed the first Soviet prototype of an ordinary CD player – Corvette LP-001. Unfortunately, there are no photos of this device, but there are a lot of others mid-80s Soviet CD players that started to be manufactured in the USSR after all these events. Mostly they were made in Estonia and Russian city Bertsk, under brands Estonia and Vega. And all the microchips and CDM parts of this were made by Philips. It was much easier to import parts abroad than to manufacture here in the USSR. But as Soviet Union was under a lot of Western sanctions, it also wasn't as easy as it has to be to make a mass and affordable product. Estonian factory Punane Red found a workaround for this problem and made a deal with Czech company Tesla. And of course, this Tesla had no connection to Elon Musk's Tesla. Before World War II, part of Tesla's factories were owned by Philips, and cooperation of these two companies continued even in the age of the Cold War. In fact, some of the Philips CD players were even manufactured in Czechoslovakia, so they had access to all the needed parts and elements. Thanks to this collaboration, the first truly mass-produced Soviet CD player was born – Estonia LP-001. There were around 3,000 such players made in the period from 1988 till 1990. Someone can say that 3,000 units can't even count as a mass production, but for a country where the first CD players were made in a single copy, and its successors were made in several dozens just for high-tech exhibitions, 3,000 is really a lot. Unfortunately, there are no known Ray 002 players existing today. Only several photos on the internet and some scans of the old tech Soviet magazines from the 80s. But the history itself is quite fascinating. Especially in terms that it was made in the Soviet Union before the introduction of the compact disc. Just imagine how late consumer technology often was in the USSR. In the same 1982, when Ray 002 was shown to the public, we just got the first Soviet VHS player, Electronica VM-12. 6 years has passed from the introduction of the format, and only now some very rich Soviet people could get a VHS player. And keep in mind, as I said earlier, the fact that it was introduced didn't mean you can go to the store and buy it. Hell no! Getting a Japanese or American VHS player sometimes was even easier than buying a Soviet one. If you had a lot of money and necessary connections, of course. Rumor has it that in the 80s, one VHS player even could be traded for a car in the USSR. This is the defining thing you need to know about high-tech in the USSR. And suddenly, a CD player made before all the other world. Isn't it a miracle? Even if it isn't, in my opinion, it's at least a really interesting theme to talk about. And I hope you think so, too. Soviet Tech Tales won't take over video games on RVGC. But if you liked today's video, it will be a pleasure for me to film such episodes from time to time. There are a lot of tech stories from the Soviet Union that can be interesting for such geeks as I am. And if you, my beloved viewer, is also one of them, please let me know it in the comments section below. I already have, for example, two pending stories about Soviet laserdisc player and Soviet smart home in my pocket. And I'll be glad to share them with you, if you want it. Thank you for watching this episode. I really hope you've had a great time. Please press thumbs up, subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you next time. Have a nice day. Good luck!